and welcome to another vlog, guys. And today is gonna be a really special one. Today we're in Berlin. It's really early and I am super tired. Actually slept most of the way here. This is Carsten.
Hey.
That's Marion.
Hey.
You guys know Kim?
Hello.
Hello. He grew up in East Germany back in the days. And we're gonna show you some really special places because he used to work here as well, right where the Berlin Wall was. And he's gonna tell us a little bit about it, right?
Yeah, so you can see here the original Berlin Wall, the last piece of it, which has been preserved as a place to remember how it was. So this wall has been built to protect East Germany from the enemies from outside, at least they told us, but in fact it was built to keep the people of East Germany in East Germany and prevent them from moving away to the western part. Yeah, what you can see here is the original western part of the wall. So this wall was still sitting on East German's ground. So after the wall there was from 1 to 5 meters still East German ground, and the real border was after the wall. That is a special place of the Berlin Wall. You can see here this gate going through this graveyard. So the West German people were allowed to visit their graves there, but the eastern part of the people here were not allowed to move to the western part. It was only possible between, I guess, 8 until 5 p.m. or so. And then this was closed.
So you guys know, if you ever researched the Berlin Wall, it was really, really strict. That was definitely no play back then. Because if you, if you tried to go over, you got shot, right?
Yes. A lot of people died here because they tried to move over the borderline. The Berlin borderline was one of the most secured in the world, best secured.
So that's crazy. And was it only from the eastern side or was it from the western side as well?
It was to protect or to prevent people coming from east to west. So you have the different elements. You see here these metal pieces. This was the backside of the wall. There was another wall here to prevent people coming. Then after this wall, there was an electronic fence which gave an alarm if you touched this one or if you cut that one. And after that, there was a special carbon. I don't know. A special ditch to prevent people coming with any vehicles here through. And also that was lighted. You see still these lamps here. It was lighted through the night. And every 200 meters or so there was an observation tower where the military people was sitting on and watching that nobody is coming. And if you made it over the first fence and over the signal fence, you still had this really high wall in front of you. It was 3.50 meters, if I remember right. And on top there was a cutted pipe so that you don't have the chance to climb on, because you glided down with your hands. So you wouldn't have needed an kind of stair or whatever to come over this wall. It was nearly impossible, but still people made it.
One of those watchtowers is actually back there. We're gonna show you guys later. It's really interesting to hear these stories because that wasn't my time period. I wasn't even born yet. It's just crazy if you think about how strict everything was and how, because Eastern Germany didn't have a lot of stuff, right? I mean, they had everything they pretty much needed to live, but Western Germany was, I mean, tell the difference. It's really crazy.
We got the broadcast from the Western TV and radio station, so everybody was aware how it is in Western Germany and West Berlin. And in Eastern, yeah, the living was okay, so we had everything, but it was not as colorful, and we were not allowed to travel somewhere else besides the Eastern parts. And So the people wanted to see other things. And we had even special stores here in eastern part of Germany called Intershop. If you came into these stores, you smelled this very special smell of Western Germany. And this was desirable for a lot of people to see this. On these pictures you can see how it really looked like. So this is the western part of the wall, the eastern part of the wall. Between there's the fence, which you can see here. There's the way where the military guys walked to prevent anybody to move on there. Also here on the upper picture you see these special elements to prevent any vehicle to come through.
These parts right here, sorry if I'm squinting, it's so bright. I'm gonna move behind the tree real quick, hold on. So these parts right here, those are actually some of the big parts of wall that stand over there. So I guess they just put them here for show?
Yeah, just to preserve them, because the souvenir hunters just used every piece of the wall to make money out of it.
Oh, okay.
So the wall came down.
Yeah. All right, so yeah, these are just here to preserve them. And I guess the other wall that was on the east side was a little bit smaller,
he said? Yeah, this is that one. It was about 2 meters high, 2 meters 20 or so. So it was easier to come over, but it really didn't help you, because if you came over, you had these electronic fence in front of you, and the military guys would have approached you very fast and even shoot on you.
They put up pictures for everyone that tried to cross the wall and got shot on the way or died on the way, which there's a lot of people on here.
That one was the last one who got shot on the wall and lost his life. It was in February 1989, so a short few months before the wall came down. It is really crazy.
Tell us how you feel about all the people getting shot. Did you like were you here when some of those got shot too?
No, because I was 18 months here to protect the wall, but not directly on the wall. I was more in the background, so preserving communications like this. But we also had to stay on the wall on some nights, and I show you later on where I stood many nights. It is still a crazy feeling to see all these people die just to live in freedom, and it's not easy, but it was the time. So we were forced to do this, so we had an order to do this, so we had no chance to say no. So you had the chance to not shoot on the people, but if you did this, you ended up in jail, in military jail, which is really not a thing you would like to do.
Show you guys a little bit of history of what the place was actually like.
You see here original parts of the Bergmannstraße, as well as elements of the first fence, of the first border fence they built here. It was then improved by this huge wall, but as they started here to close the borderline, they just built a simple fence and just to protect. Here in this box you can see original parts of the graveyard wall, the original, which has been teared down to build the borderline. Original, this is very, this is a very old graveyard here. We will show you later, but it has been made flat for the borderline. In this box here are original parts of the illumination system, so findings for these lamps which you can see there, and as well as original cable things, because every night they made a night today to prevent people using the darkness coming over the borderline, so it was impossible. It was extremely lighted here. It was like a day to prevent people using the darkness. And here you see some parts of the original electronic fence to prevent people coming over. So if they pass the first wall, they had the electronic fence in front of them. This electronic fence gave an alarm in case of you cut them, in case of you touch them, and it was a really loud alarm called the bullhorn. And this one is the backside wall, the eastern part. So from until here you could walk, but only on days. If I remember right, starting at 10 p.m. this was also an area where you're not allowed to walk on. So during the nights, even military people did watch here. And I'll show you later where I was sitting many nights to watch, especially that place that no one was walking here overnight. Yeah, during the nights, we walked here going exactly to that wall. There was some spaces in between where you could look through, and we looked through to the other wall, just thinking about what would be if you could be on the other side in the western part. But even that was dangerous, because the next observation tower, which is in this direction, the people there were happy watching us, and they was not really happy if we are so close, or if we are so close to the wall, even if we also have been members of the military. They approached us and sent us back. You can see there this bench. That is exactly the bench where we sat night overnight and eating our stuff during the night. Exactly that one is still there.
For all the guys out there that are watching this video right now, how many nights did you sit there actually? Like how many months?
I had to serve here for 18 months, and during that time I was here directly at this place, I would say 10 to 15 times exactly at that place. So 10 to 15 nights I spent here watching the graves. Did not see any zombies here, just some animals. And nothing happened here. It was totally boring these nights. It is really hard to transport the feeling if you stay here later on and you stood here in the 80s seeing this borderline, not able to cross the borderline, and now it's free for everyone. And you really cannot imagine the feeling if you got the message that the wall came down. At that point I was working in a computation center as a service technician. We just closed the computation center, jumped on the car and drove over to Berlin and crossed the wall just to get this feeling. I cannot really describe that. You need to discover that by yourself, otherwise you can just talk about that, but it's hard to understand for people not being in this situation.
What was the first stop that you actually went to when the walls came down?
I crossed the borderline at the Oberbaumbrücke and was there in Berlin-Kreuzberg, which is a special place here in Berlin, a very unique community there. And I guess the first place I went into was an vegetable shop to buy a kiwi. It was amazing, because these kind of fruits were not available in Eastern Germany, and I just went in and bought a kiwi.
Food wise, I guess there was a lot of stuff that wasn't available here, like not just vegetables or fruits, but like what are the biggest differences that were available in the western and not in the eastern part of Germany back in the days?
It started from technical things like TVs, color TVs, for instance. It was really hard to get a color TV in Eastern Germany. We just had black and white TVs, and also some simple things like Walkman. You could not buy a Walkman in Eastern Germany. It was only available in Western part. And if you look to cars, we just had Trabant or Wartburg, and you had to wait between 10 and 15 years to get one. And here you could buy any kind of car you would like. You just needed the money for that. And also it was way more colorful. If you came over the borderline, it was a completely different feeling. It was colorful, it smelled different, and yeah, it's hard to describe.
So colorful because of the houses, or?
It starts from the houses, and there was also advertising everywhere, so neon advertising, and even the cars had different colors there, and yeah, it looked completely different. Hmm. In Eastern Germany, it was more grayish and black and white, and yeah, even the people wore clothes which were not really colorful, because it was just functional, but it was not made for design purposes.
And you said that you didn't have Walkmans over here. Were you allowed to have one if you got your hands on one? Or
yes. One of the specialties of the East German people was to have connections everywhere. And if you had connections, for instance, to Polish people working here and working in the Western part, you were able to get this stuff, but to prices which were much higher than you would had to pay in Western parts. We need to compare the currency. So we had a special or our own currency here in Eastern Germany called Mark der DDR, Ostmark. One Westmark, Deutschmark from the Western part was 10 Ostmark. If you would like to buy a TV at that time, it was around 200 Westmarks or so. You would have to pay 2,000 Ostmark for that.
Wow, okay, that's a big jump there. Definitely. How much money did you make a month over here?
My first salary was about 600 Ostmarks, which is about 60 Westmarks, or 30 euros, if you compare that.
So you would have to pretty much save up 4 months straight to just get a TV?
Yeah. And you would not be able to spend anything besides, so you would not get something to eat, and you would not pay your rent.
Okay, so the salary wasn't that much here, but how much was living costs in general? Like, how much did you pay for food, everything together? So you had 600 bucks every month,
yeah.
East Mark. How much of that was living costs with houses and everything?
I would say about a quarter of that you would have to spend. So a standard three-room flat costed us 59 Ostmarks per month. A bread was 50 Pfennige, 50 cents. And yeah, a beer, also a bottle of beer was 50 Pfennige, 50 pence, and yeah, it was way cheaper.
But still, so you got a quarter of that you spent for living costs?
Yeah.
And then you only had like 400, well, yeah, around 400, 400, oh, where am I pointing the camera? So you only had 450 bucks left, and what did you do with the rest? Did you save it? Did you go about your day and did cool things in here? Were there actually cool things to experience in these parts of Germany, like holidays or whatever? What were you able to do here?
So we still went to holiday, but only in the places we were allowed to, like the Baltic Sea and the eastern parts of the world, like Russia, Czechoslovakia, Hungary. We were able to go there, and we just used the money to have activities like this. You also could buy some cars, your Eastern cars, but you would have to pay for a Trabant 8,000 Deutschmarks. But the other issue with that is you had to wait 10 to 15 years to get one. So you had enough time to save. But the money was also used to buy Westmark, to have some other stuff, to buy some other stuff. And yeah, a lot of people just bought houses. They have been cheap at that time and renovated them and yeah, this stuff.
And two more questions before we go to the place that you actually sat at. One is, were you able to buy used cars here?
Yes.
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 So you didn't have to wait 15 years, you could just
that
buy
is right.
a used
this
car.
This one was one of the biggest markets anyway, to sell or buy a used car.
Mm, okay.
Starting from Eastern cars, even you could get West cars.
Oh, you could even get West cars here.
Yes, they got imported, a few of them for the Berlin people and for special folks, and they got also sold then to the aftermarket, and so you could buy them, but you would need a lot of money to buy them.
And what else did you do to occupy yourselves here, like every day, not just holidays, not just like special occasions, but every day? Were there games that you could play? Were there like places to go to have a nice dinner, to have nice like gaming rooms or something like that?
No, at that time there were no gaming rooms. We just met and had fun together outside, just walked in the nature, and sometimes just sit together and put something on the barbecue and had fun at that time. So we had been more closer with other people sitting there, because there was no electronic gadget at this time. We didn't have any handy phones like this or computers. It wasn't available, so we just did other things. The green borderline outside of Berlin, so between the eastern and western part of Germany, there had been special equipment to shoot people automatically, so-called SM-70 Personenmine, called self-shooting device, I would say. These things were really deadly. If you hit them, they just shoot out a bunch of special metal parts, sharp metal parts, and you lost a lot of blood and died on that. Franz Josef Strauß negotiated a special credit for the eastern part of Germany, and with that credit he urged the German government, East German government, to demount these devices to save lives.
This was actually one of the what's it called?
Observation tower.
Observation towers, where they had a look if everything was going the way they wanted it to go.
This is really an original part of the Berlin Wall, which is preserved to show the people how it really looked like. If you look here through this small gap, I don't know if the GoPro gets this, you can see how it really looked like at the time, the column way, and there's also some parts of the electronic fence visible there. Yeah, and if you look at the tower, just remember the shape of the tower. That is a new one, this square shaped one. Later on we will visit an older one which was really dangerous, especially if wind came up, because they started to shake these things. And then even there were some falling down on strong winds. I show you later.
So we actually can't visit his bench where he sat at back in the days, because it's all closed off. Don't know why. Maybe now there's zombies, probably. But yeah, so what are we gonna check out next?
Next we will visit one of the older observation towers, which is sitting in the middle of the city. Also there's an old part of the original wall. Just be surprised.
So right now we're gonna walk through this tree, and then Carsten is gonna show us.
This is not a square, it is round. Issue with that kind of towers was that they are unstable, or that they have been unstable, especially if strong winds came, they started to shake, and some of them also collapsed.
So they collapsed while people were in there?
Yes, even there people got hurt.
There was an entrance right here where you could go up, so don't want to touch it, but that's the door to go in. And then you had a ladder to go out?
Yes, there's a metal ladder inside. You had to climb up, and on top of this tower always two people were watching the borderline that nobody is was escaping. That is a picture how it looked like at the GDR times, so it's all empty. You see here the borderline, the original border wall. The tower we are standing right is here, you can see here, and the whole area, here's the back wall, the backside wall, the eastern wall, and between that all was empty.
And again, look at how beautiful this is. Berlin is so huge. I mean, how long do you think it would take to see all of Berlin?
I would say a year or so.
Yeah, so bring some time with you guys if you can ever come to Berlin. Do you have anything else to show us? For now?
Yeah, this special currywurst.
Special currywurst, yeah.
And there are tons of other places to show, but in the short of the time we have. Look at this, this bridge there is the so-called the Oberbahnbrücke. That was the bridge I crossed on the day when the wall came down.
Oh, okay, so that bridge back there, I hope you can see it with the two pointy tips. Anyways, but the rest we're gonna show you another time, because he's got so many stories to tell from Berlin, from the days back in the day. And really interesting to hear all the stories, and I'm super excited to hear more that I didn't hear yet. That's gonna be content for another video. Now we're gonna go eat currywurst. So we're at a really, really cool place that is here since when?
1936.
1936, it's called Kanopkes Imbiss, and look at this side shot, looks really cool. Anyway, so we're gonna eat, and I'm not gonna tell you how it tastes because you gotta come here yourself to try it out, and I'm really excited to try it. So until next time, guys, stay safe, stay well, and what else?
Guten Appetit.
Yeah, guten Appetit. Like, comment, subscribe, hit the bell, and we'll see you guys later. I'm gonna get it.